Tatata. Lord, we are just praying. We are praying for your word tonight. We're praying for the living word tonight. We're praying for your spirit tonight. In the name of Jesus, that your word will come as life to us. In the name of Jesus, your word will add to us. In the name of Jesus, Mashata Gagagadosa, Rabababababababababababosa, Elegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedegedeged Lord, we don't want the letters. We want spirit. We want spirit. We want spirit in the name of Jesus Christ. That we might be quickened in our souls in the name of Jesus. We pray, Lord, that even as we start, we pray, Lord, that you would help us. You would help us in every way that we need help. You know every individual here. In any way that we need help, you would strengthen us in the name of Jesus. You would strengthen our bodies. You would speak life to our souls in the name of Jesus. You would help us. You would help us. You would help all of our infirmities tonight. You would help all of our infirmities tonight in areas where we are not responding to you. We will begin to respond to you in the name of Jesus Christ. We pray that you would help us. In Jesus' mighty name we've prayed. Amen.
As the Spirit was moving over the waters, Spirit, come move over us. Come rest on us. Come rest on us. As the Spirit was moving over the waters, Spirit, come move over us. Come rest on us. Come rest on us. Pound. When you fill the room, you're here and I.
Oh, Divine visitation. I just pray, God, that you would just visit us in a way that we have never ever known before, and that you would bring us into an encounter with your presence and your power, and that we would even experience a Shekinah manifestation of your divine presence. In your word, it says, "I have set this day, set you over the nations and over the kingdoms to root out and to pull down, to destroy and to throw down, to build and to plant." You said, "Ask of me and I will give to you the nations as an inheritance." And we pray right now that this can only be accomplished for the divine visitation, with a divine appointment, that you would just empower us, that you would just, by your grace, Lord Jesus Christ, that you would just empower us through your Holy Spirit. We just pray that your Holy Spirit would just move among us, that it would just move among us in a powerful way, and it would just cause us to want to just go out and just reach the nations, that would just cause us to want to just move out and just go forward and just go outwards and just move in an outward direction. I just pray in your name that there would be a sweeping wind across this, across all of this land, that your blessing and your glory would be released upon us this day, and that revival fire is burning, and it is coming, and that your glory will be here and when it comes, and that nothing will stop it, and that even now that you're raising, and that people in this area of Portage the Prairie out of slumber, and that they would come, and that they would know what was happening here, and that they would just wake up from their sleep, and that they would just come over here, and they would just fall in line as your armies mobilize. We just pray, Lord Jesus, for the mobilization of your army, and we just pray, Lord, that you would just be with us even right here in these small beginnings, and that they would become larger, and that it would increase, and that they would grow. And this can only happen when you give us your empowerment, and that only happens through your Holy Spirit. We just pray, Lord Jesus, that you would just move among us in this way. Just move among us. Just move among us like you've never moved before us. In Jesus' name we have prayed.
Hallelujah. Let's just continue to bless his name tonight. Just bless him. He's worthy of all our praise. He's worthy to receive all the glory. He's worthy to receive all the honor. Father, we bless you. Father, we bless you. We say, have your way in the name of Jesus. We say, have your way in the name of Jesus. We say, have your way. Have your way, oh Lord. We bless you. We bless you. We give you praises. We give you honor. We give you adoration. You are worthy of all our praise. 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 In the name of Jesus. In Jesus' mighty name we've prayed. Amen. I quickly read from the book of Ephesians, Ephesians 1, 17. It says that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of him. 18, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that ye may know what is the hope of his calling and what is the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints. 17 says that he will give unto you the spirit of wisdom. The spirit of wisdom. We are praying for the spirit of wisdom tonight in the name of Jesus. We have just 5 minutes. The spirit of wisdom. Say, Lord, release your spirit of wisdom. Spirit of wisdom is a spirit. Father, we ask that you fill us with the spirit of wisdom tonight. You fill us with the spirit of wisdom. Give us wisdom. Give us wisdom. Give us wisdom. When Jesus showed up, he said, one that is wiser than Solomon is here. Give us wisdom. Give us wisdom, because you possess all wisdom is with you. All wisdom is with you. Father, we thank you because you are the embodiment of wisdom. And we have you, O Lord. We shall not lack wisdom. We shall not lack wisdom. The Bible says in Proverbs, it says, wisdom stand on the streets and cry. Father, we give you praises for wisdom. Release your wisdom. Release your wisdom. Release the spirit of 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 wisdom. Let your wisdom be released unto us, that we'll operate in your wisdom. We'll move in your wisdom. We give you praises. We give you honor. We give you thanks. We give you glory. Let just the spirit of wisdom be released in this place. In this place, in the name of Jesus, a wisdom that is higher than the wisdom of the world. Give us wisdom. Give us wisdom that we may display the manifold glory of God, the manifold grace of God. Father, we thank you for wisdom tonight. We give you praise. In Jesus' mighty name we've prayed. Amen.
Hallelujah. Shall we have our seat in his presence? May the Lord bless us in Jesus' name. Praise the name of the Lord. I just want to welcome us to his presence tonight. I pray we will not live the same way we have come in Jesus' name. This is just an announcement time and a time to give unto the Lord. Time to give offering unto the Lord. If you have an offering and you really want to bless the name of the Lord with it, this is the time you can do that. Do we have it on the screen already? Yeah, we have it on the screen already. You can do interact to donate at rccgremasanctuary.org. And as you do that, the Lord bless you in Jesus' name. And our announcements still remain the same. We meet every Tuesday, 7 p.m. to 8:30. And by the grace of God, we are trusting God that very soon our Sunday service will commence. And there's also need for us to ensure that we tell people about Jesus out there and we invite them to church. The scripture says we should not despise this of little beginning. We will grow even larger than this in the name of Jesus. Shall we rise on our feet as we dance to appreciate God with our offering and prepare to hear the sermon tonight? Hallelujah. Song.
Lord, I confess bowing here I find my rest. Without you I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every deep Your grace is more. Grace is found. Is where you are. Where you comes my way. When I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay.
Father, in the name of Jesus, we bless you for the privilege we give unto you, and we ask that you bless this offering in the name of Jesus, and we ask that you bless us in return in the name of Jesus. In this service this evening, have your will in Jesus' name. We ask that you bring your word that is spirit and life. Father, bring it to us and bless us with it in Jesus' name. Thank you, glorious Father. In Jesus' name we pray.
God. Amen. Oh, the presence of God is here tonight. Powerful. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Just stand one more time and let's just. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, we just, you are in the room tonight, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Every heart that is hungry and thirsts, Lord, fill tonight, Lord God. Fill, Lord, tonight. In Jesus' name, Lord. Every body that is struggling, Lord, with weariness or sickness or whatever, Lord, touch, Lord, tonight. Minister, Lord, tonight. Minister grace, Lord. Minister power, minister healing, minister strength, Lord, to us tonight, Lord. Lord, we just glorify you. We give you praise, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. All that matters, Lord, is that you are here. We are here and you are here. And Lord, we just thank you for that. Thank you for that. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. It's a privilege to share tonight again. I love to speak, so when I get asked, I'm good. One time, Lord said to me, if you're ever asked to speak or preach, you just say yes, and then I'll give you the words. And that's how it should work. If this is what God has called you to do, then that's what you should be doing. And so it is a privilege to share tonight again. And I want to share tonight on what is a series that I did a few years ago called Building Foundations. Building Foundations. The Lord kind of just spoke this, whispered this to me on Sunday night as we attended the concert with Neon and Rhema in Winnipeg. And then I got a sense, okay. And that's how it works a lot of times. God will speak into our lives something, and then it's in preparation for what we're to share and to speak on. And Building Foundations, and this is number two in the series. It's called The Secret Place of Prayer. The Secret Place of Prayer. How many know or been around construction work when there's the foundation is being laid and the groundwork is being done? Have you ever seen that? I love that. If we're passing by construction sites and there's things happening, and there's holes in the ground and there's concrete, and to me that's exciting. I absolutely love that, watching that. I could just stop and watch that all day long, the work that is happening and what is being constructed and what is being raised up and what is happening. And foundations are very important. What would happen if we didn't have foundations in buildings? What would happen? Things wouldn't be right. The building wouldn't be able to stand. It would not be able to hold up. There would be some problems. Maybe they wouldn't show up right away, immediately, but over time, and probably in a very short period of time, the building would begin to move and shift, and cracks would appear, and it would not be a good situation for that building, and more than likely the building wouldn't stand. It wouldn't last. Foundations are very important, and how we lay that foundation is very important. And I remember a story, and actually my wife shares a story, which I always find so interesting to listen to. And if she was here tonight, I'd have her share it, but she's a little under the weather, kind of worn out tonight. And so she talks about a time in Norway where she's from, where she helped her dad to build a wall. And in Norway, it's a very wet climate, and so they use a lot of rock and cement and concrete, because things will rot if it's not made to last. And if you don't use rock and concrete with all the humidity and moisture, there could be a problem in whatever you're constructing. And so she helped her dad build a wall, and they worked and worked and worked to start building that wall, and slowly the wall started to come up. And then this was, I think, in the evening or whatever, and then she went off to school the next day. She came back home, and all their work had been demolished by her father. He had torn it down. And she goes, well, why did you do that? He said, because the foundation, the wall was off just a little bit. And if we would have continued to build that wall, it would have started to lean, and then it wouldn't have lasted. It would have fallen over. And sometimes that's the way it is in our lives. We start building something, and it's not right. And we have to go back, and we have to make things right. And go back to the beginning. Sometimes we have to do that. Sometimes in our lives, in our projects, and the things that we're doing, and because it's very important that we start out right. It's very important that we get the right, we go in the right direction. We get going properly, so that in the future, what is happening in that building and that project is going to last. It's going to be something that continues. It's going to be something that doesn't have problems, reoccurring problems. How many of you like? I don't like reoccurring problems. I don't like that. I don't like obstacles. In fact, I just don't like things getting in my way. I like to keep going when I'm driving. I told Glory that Joy the other day when I'm driving. I don't like things. I don't like red lights and stop signs. But they're important. But we don't like things that don't work, and become obstacles, or become things that are not right, and have reoccurring issues and problems in our lives. And so it's best just to start out right. And I believe that we're in a foundational time. This is a foundational time, and we're beginning. We're seeking the Lord. We're starting a work. And essentially, we're laying a foundation. We're laying a foundation on things that are going to be happening in the future. And things are going to be happening in the future. They are. They are. It's just something we cannot get away from. You know, you look, you know, small beginnings, right? And it's easy to get discouraged and say, okay, not a whole lot's happening. And where are the people? We're talking to people, we're sharing, we're inviting, we're reaching out. And I believe there's going to come, there's something is going to happen, and we're going to see something begin to happen and build upon what is being laid and what we're doing. And so the subtitle for what I'm sharing is Prayer is Foundational for What God Wants to Do. Prayer is foundational for what God wants to do. And just like much of the foundation of a construction building project remains hidden after the construction of the building. So normally we look and we see a building, but we don't see the foundation. The foundation is hidden. It's not necessarily something that is visible. You know, you can see it and find it because it's there, but it's not necessarily visible. And really, there are things that God wants to do that are not always visible. They're not always visible in our lives. They're not always visible in a ministry. You know, when you walk into a ministry or a church and things are happening, there's usually reasons why there's things that are happening and there's things that are not visible. You can tell a church that is praying or not. You can tell a church that is praying or not. Because God is doing something. There's something happening. There's a foundation. There's something underneath that's holding up what God is doing and wants to do. So turn Matthew 6, 5 to 8. Matthew chapter 6, verses 5 to 8. We will start out there this evening. And when you pray, do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and on the street corners to be seen by others. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward in full. But when you pray, go into your room, close the door, and pray to your Father who is unseen. And then your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. Amen? When your Father sees what you're doing that no one else can see, He will be the one that rewards you. And when you pray, do not keep on babbling like pagans, for they think they will be heard because of their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask Him. When I was about 17 years of age, God got a hold of my life. It was a powerful thing that happened. I grew up in the church. In fact, my father was a pastor for some years, for a few years. And I was around church, prayer meetings, preaching the word. But I had basically at some point tuned out. God really did a work when I was a little younger, and then through my teens. You know how it is. You're going to school, and there's lots of peer pressure and stuff happening. And I wasn't serious. And then God came into my life in a powerful way. And I remember taking these verses, and these verses were significant for me at that time, and continue to be. And in fact, they were so significant for me that one day I. In the King James Version, I believe the verses say, go into your closet and close the door. And so I took all the stuff out of my closet and I climbed into it. And I was full of zeal, right? 17, teenager. And the only problem is my closet was very small and it was very uncomfortable and it didn't work so well. But that was the hunger that was there. Just to take things literally in the Word of God and seek. And I would go into my room and I would seek the Lord. Seek Him and seek Him and seek Him. And begin to pray for my friends, my unsaved friends, and that God would work and move. And in the next couple of years, I was able to lead several of them to the Lord. And it was a powerful time that we had. We saw revival. We saw many get saved and God move and work. And I believe it all started in my life. It all started by getting alone with the Lord and taking this literally and just saying, Lord, I am here. I am seeking you. And you know how the Lord would reward me? And I believe that the verses here translated have an idea here of what it means to reward you. And there's some meaning there that has to do with revealing himself to you. Revealing himself to you. And that's what the Lord did. He just revealed himself to me in such a real and powerful way. And that has to start when we get alone and we find a place that we can seek the Lord and be alone with him and hear him and fellowship with him and call out to him and cry out to him. And his presence begins to grow and intensify as we do that, as we do that. What is prayer? What is prayer? Prayer in its purest form is understood in the Bible as communication, right? Very simply, it's communication. And that's where it has to start. It's basically and simply communication. And it's communication between us, ourselves, and God. And that's what prayer is. And don't get confused. It's communication. Prayer is also the primary practice that defines our intimacy with our Lord and our Savior. It's very hard to be intimate and to know somebody if you're not communicating. If we're not communicating and we're hearing, listening, speaking, talking, sharing, it's very hard to have a close and intimate relationship with a person or with the Lord, with our God. And it really defines it. The Bible it talks about prayer as really the definition of our, really ultimately, it's really at the core of a relationship with our God is prayer. And the greater our prayer life, then the deeper and the closer our walk that we have with the Lord. And there's no way of going around that fact. Anybody that is walking with the Lord, close to the Lord, used by God, will have a prayer life. And the more that God uses them, the more and the deeper that prayer life is and will be and needs to be. Many times we can coast along without praying for and going without prayer for a period of time, but it will catch up. It will catch up. Prayer is absolutely the focus and the primary practice that defines our intimacy with our Lord. As Christians, there can only be three reasons that we don't pray. Number one, we are backslidden and away from the Lord and living our own lives. Number two, we are deeply discouraged in the midst of a great trial of faith or of great pain. Or number three, we are not truly born again and we are only religious and have never really encountered the true and the living God. Those are really the only three reasons why we don't pray. We are backslidden. We are in a deep discouragement time and just not able to pray. It happens in the Bible. It happened. Or we are not really born again. So number one, what was prayer? Number two, prayer should be instinctive to the believer and the church. Instinctive. Does everybody know what that word means? Instinct means it's an instinct. It's just automatic. It happens. Prayer should be instinctive to the believer and the church. It is crucial that we understand our responsibility in prayer. Prayer is not an option. For the follower of Christ, prayer should be like breathing. Prayer should be like breathing. In the New Testament scriptures, we are encouraged many times to pray as much as possible, to even pray without ceasing. 1 Thessalonians 5:17. When Jesus taught in prayer in Matthew 6, which we know, of course, as the Lord's Prayer, he repeated the words, when you pray, three times, as it was presupposed that his followers would pray. Three times, when you pray, in verse 5 of Matthew 6, and when you pray, do not be like the hypocrites. And when you pray, go into your room and close the door. And when you pray, do not keep babbling on like pagans. It's instinctive. Prayer is or should be the distinguishing aspect of the people of God. It should be what distinguishes us. We should be known for praying. We should be known. However, how often are we known as the people of God? How often are we known? We may be known for great music. We may be known for having great food and potlucks and fellowship times. And those are all good. We may be known for having great and big buildings. But the distinguishing aspect of the people of God should be their praying, their calling unto the Lord. Matthew 21:13. It is written, he said to them, my house will be called a house of prayer, but you are making it a den of robbers. And Jesus, when he was speaking, was distinguishing what his house, what the people of God, the gathering of God's people, should be distinguished as and known for. And it should be known as a place and a people of prayer. It is important that God calls his house not a house of preaching, singing, potlucks, even though these things are important, but primarily as a house of prayer. A place where people can join together and seek the Lord. And you know, one of the most exciting things that I see happening around the world when I see great works of God is the prayer movement and the prayer meetings that are happening in that congregation, in that people. If you look at some of the great churches, I'm thinking of Yonggi Cho's church, who's recently passed away in South Korea. And people would say, how in the world does a church grow to a million members? And you look back and you listen and you hear the testimony of this man of God praying, and then the church praying, and then God moving and working and just keep continuing to add to their numbers as they did in Acts 2 in the book of Acts. And if you see these prayer meetings that they have, and as far as I know, they still happen on Friday nights. They fill a stadium of 50,000 people that are praying all night long. They have a prayer mountain where thousands are gathering continuously praying. And what does that do? It does something spiritually, and I don't know if we always fully understand, but I remember a story that Yonggi Cho told about how they were trying to establish churches in Japan, and they were finding it very difficult. They couldn't seem to get any traction, and it was hard to penetrate that dark area spiritually. And so I think the Lord just led him, and he rented a jumbo jet or whatever, and flew over a bunch of people from Japan to South Korea to their church, and businessmen and leaders and unsaved people, and they all got saved. And then they went back, and there was, because they came into an environment of prayer. They came into an environment where God is working and moving, and their spiritual eyes were opened, and they could see their lostness. They could see the greatness of God. They became convicted of their sins, and they turned to the Lord. And that's what prayer can do. That's the power of prayer. Number three, prayer is spiritual communication. Prayer is spiritual communications. I want to read this. As Christians, we are born again into the kingdom of light, and our spirit has been regenerated and made alive. Then we instinctively communicate through prayer with our Heavenly Father. After our spirit has been made alive, instinctively we begin to pray and communicate with our Heavenly Father. It becomes a normal and natural, or you could say supernatural, response as a new creation. We no longer put our faith and our trust in this world and the things of this world. We now belong to a different kingdom, and prayer is the means in which we connect with that realm. All right, we're not of this world. We're in this world, but we're not of this world. And when we become born again, there's a connection that happens with God. And we desire to be in his presence. We desire to seek his face. How do we communicate with God? We communicate God through the part of us that he has created us to communicate with him. And what is that? What has he put in us to communicate with him? Our spirit. Our spirit. It goes beyond our mind, our thoughts. There's a part of us God has regenerated in us that we can have that fellowship and that communication with God. When Jesus encountered the Samaritan woman at the well, he needed to help her understand that everything was changing or about to change, if you remember that encounter. She believed, as did the Jews, that the relationship with God was limited to a physical location. And where was that location supposed to be? Or where was it located? Where was the relationship with God and God's revealed glory happening in the Old Testament? In the temple. In the temple. It was a temple worship-based thing. Woman, Jesus replied, believe me, a time is coming when you will worship the Father neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. You Samaritans worship what you do not know. We worship what we do know, for salvation is from the Jews. That's true. Yet a time is coming, and now has come, when true worshipers will worship the Father in what? In the Spirit and in truth. For they are the kind of worshipers the Father seeks. God is what? He's a spirit. It's just that simple. It's just that simple. And yet when I talk to believers about that, they get spooked out. I'm serious. It's like we have this incredible spiritual life that we can have with God because God is a spirit, and that's the only way to do it. So many want to jump through a lot of hoops to try to have a relationship with God. That's not what it's about. God is a spirit, and his worshipers must worship in the Spirit. Everybody say, in the Spirit.
In the Spirit.
That's it. That's the key. In the Spirit. It's a lot of work if we don't do it in the Spirit. If we don't learn to flow in the Spirit and move in the Spirit and function in the Spirit, it's work, it's religion, it's dead, and it goes nowhere. All it does is it just puffs up people. In Ephesians 6:18, Paul is exhorting believers to pray in the Spirit. Pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. At the heart of prayer is praying in the Spirit. That's the heart of prayer. And then through that, we can pray in different ways, and we can communicate in different ways. We can ask the Lord. We can intercede. We can do all these things, but it's got to be in the Spirit. Through our spirit, we can pray and connect with God's Spirit. This happens whenever we pray and with all kinds of prayers. Romans 8:26, we learn that the Spirit helps us to pray, and sometimes these prayers are expressed through wordless groans. That's the Spirit praying. We don't even know how to pray. And it just comes out of us from deep within. We begin to groan. We begin to even weep before the Lord as the Spirit prays in and through us. In the same way, the Spirit helps us in our weaknesses. We do not know what we ought to pray for, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us through wordless groans. Number four, prayer was essential in the early church. Prayer was essential in the early church. The church was birthed from a prayer meeting.
It actually started in a prayer meeting. After Jesus' ascension, his disciples, it said in Acts 1:14, continued with one accord in prayer. And in fact, when Jesus said, don't do anything until you receive the promise from on high. Wait, pray, seek my face. And when the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. And they were praying. That's what happened, when it started. That's how it started. When the church was established on Pentecost, they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship, in the breaking of bread, and in prayers. Acts 2:42. When the church faced challenges and crises, they prayed. In Acts 12, the church experienced a time of persecution. King Herod began arresting Christians and persecuting the church, and even had James, the brother of John, put to death by the sword. He then seized Peter and had him thrown in prison. Things were very serious. It was so serious. Imagine this, they had this one guy in prison, and they had him guarded by four squads of four soldiers each. 16 soldiers were guarding him. Like, what were they worried about? He intended to make an example of Peter by having a trial after Passover. And we know that this trial would have turned out when conducted by a tyrant in order to please the Jews. There was one goal, and that was to get rid of Peter, to make the Jews happy. And so what happened? You remember the story? Acts 12:5. Peter was kept in prison, but the church was what? In fact, it says, earnestly praying. They weren't going to settle for that. How many times do we, oh, okay, God, I guess that's your will. Peter's in jail now, and our, you know, he's a great leader and preacher, and that's, there's nothing we can do. Let's just accept that. Accept the defeat, and we'll go on from there. Maybe God will do something more. And no. They began to earnestly pray to God for him. And what happened? This is an incredible event. The night before Herod was to bring him to trial, Peter was sleeping between two soldiers. They were like, we're not letting go of this guy. He's like, he's in for it. Bound with chains, with sentries standing guard. What happened? An angel of the Lord suddenly appeared, and everything changed. The angel awakened Peter. The chains immediately fell off Peter's wrists, and he was told to get dressed and to follow him out of the prison. And it's, the Bible says that Peter was in like a trance-like state, and he followed the angel past the first and second guards and past the iron gate leading to the city, and basically just walked right out of there. And in fact, the gate opened by itself, right? This is a supernatural thing. This is in response to the earnest praying of the believers. And Peter was alone. He became suddenly alone and free and set free. He went to the house of Mary, the mother of John, where many people had gathered and were praying, still praying for his release. In fact, they were shocked. They were shocked. I mean, you'd think that maybe they were praying in faith, but I think they were more praying in desperation. All right? God answers our prayers when we're even if sometimes we don't. They were, what happened when he got to the door? Does anybody remember? He thought it was his ghost, and they slammed the door on him, and I think it was a young lady, whatever, ran back inside. What's going on? There's somebody at the door. It looks like Peter. We're not sure. Do we actually believe that God was going to do something? Yeah, he's there. God did it. Amen. We can pray. We can pray and ask the Lord, even if we're not totally convinced he's going to do something. That's how faith is increased, right? We just pray, and then God answers, and then we go, wow, it works, right? But we got to cry out to the Lord like he is the one that has the answer and the only one that has the answer. All right, you can always tell where your heart is by the first thing you go to when you're in a serious situation. Who do you call? If you're calling the Ghostbusters, you're calling the wrong people. Right? We are calling upon the Lord when we're in trouble. That's who we call upon. In Acts 16, we read about another serious situation. This time, Paul and Silas were severely flogged and thrown in prison during the night while they were praying and singing hymns. An earthquake occurred that opened the prison doors and released their chains. However, this time, what did they do? They remained in prison. Right? They could have gone. But God was up to something. There was a greater purpose. And they ended up leading the jailer to the Lord. The jailer suddenly became ready to hear what they had to say because his life was on the line if they would have left. And what happens? What's the outcome of that situation? The jailer is saved and his whole household is saved and baptized. And then they were released. Amen? Then they were released. Throughout the book of Acts, when the church encountered crisis, it sought the Lord for intervention. And I'm going to go over a few things again. I think I'm going to have to put a clock up there because I lose track of time very easily. Where are we at? Sorry, guys. Okay. I'm just going to quickly review a couple of the things that the early church prayed for. Its leaders and its missionaries. In Acts 13, 1-3, now the church at Antioch, there were prophets and teachers, Barnabas, Simeon, called Niger, Lucius of Cyrene, Manaen, who had been brought up with Herod the Tetrarch, and Saul, while they were worshiping the Lord and fasting. While they were worshiping the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said, set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work which I have called them. So after they had fasted and prayed, they placed their hands on them and sent them off. Everything was done in prayer. Everything was done as the Holy Spirit led them. And you can't be led by the Holy Spirit until you're in that place of communication. And you're in that place of hearing and sensing the Holy Spirit. They also prayed for the manifestation of the Holy Spirit in Acts 8:15. When they, Peter and John, arrived, they prayed for the new believers there that they might receive the Holy Spirit. Amen. We talked to some young men yesterday. They attend a church in town, some East Indian gentlemen, and it is a Pentecostal church. And so when I hear someone's going to a Pentecostal church, I'm sorry, but the first thing I'm going to ask them, are you baptized in the Holy Spirit? Are you praying in the Spirit? And well, no, not yet, not yet. And I said, well, if you want to, let me know and we'll pray for you. Right? Because we're to pray for people, and it's not rocket science to have that happen. Right? You believe, you repent, you come to faith, and then there's the Holy Spirit part that can baptize people and manifest in their lives. They prayed for sinners to repent, Acts 2:24, 26, 29. They prayed for physical safety, Acts 27:29. And of course, they prayed for healing. Example of Dorcas in Acts 9:40, Peter sent them all out of the room. Then he got down on his knees and he prayed. Turning toward the dead woman, he said, Tabitha, get up. She opened her eyes and seeing Peter, she sat up. Amen. In the song we were saying tonight, and there was another one we were going to do that had the words, get up, get up, get up. Right? Sometimes we just, that's what the Spirit is saying, get up. That's what the apostle said, get up. Tabitha, get up. She opened her eyes and seeing Peter, she sat up. She sat up. Praise God. Amen. So I want to close tonight by spending some time just praying. Right? We need to pray. And we don't just need to talk about it, but we need to actually do it as well. And we're just going to spend a few minutes. And I'm very specifically. All right, we're very, very, you know, the Lord wants us to be specific because then when he answers it, he gets the glory. right? If we're praying generally all the time, then we don't know whether it was God or if it was just a fluke, right? So we pray specifically. And and maybe there's something that's on your heart to pray for specifically. I'm going to mention a few things. I want to see an increase of people that are coming here to this meeting. I do. And it needs to happen. The Lord is here. The Lord, I believe the favor of God is here in what we're doing. And he wants to bless his work. It's his work. And people need salvation. They need to be set free. They need to be baptized. And, you know, we had a powerful Friday night service with the women here again. And something is breaking loose. And my wife has become just bold and just, she just got up for 20 minutes or 30 minutes and just began to say, we need to be praying in the Spirit. And she just released, and there was people from all kinds of backgrounds there, and Baptist ladies and others. And it just, and then this flow just began to come in the room, and we just began to, and people began to pray. And I don't even know if some of them knew what was happening, but the Spirit of God began to move and touch lives and touch hearts, and hungry people were being met. And the worship was, we're just doing worship like we do it here. And it's powerful, and God moved and worked, and these ladies, they don't even want to leave. Like, it goes on for a few hours. It's what happens when women get together, hungry women, and they have time to be in the closet, and God is moving and working, and God wants to touch people's hearts, but they need to be in the room. We need to be in fellowship together. And let's pray that God will raise up, that God will send divine appointments of people that need to be here. They're there. And give us the ability on how to reach those people, that they would come into, we would come into contact with them, and recognize that, and the Lord would work in their hearts. That's number one. Number two, we need to pray for laborers, right? Actually, before we, let's just go in that flow right now for people to come. Let's do that. Jesus, thank you, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Shikara malandarama, sikara barapataya malandarama. Iria malandora maramandaka. Yes, in Jesus' name. Shikutuko barapatataya. Lord, birth this thing, Lord God, we pray. In Jesus' name, birth this thing, Lord. Kiara mara maria kalamandora mandaya. Iria malandora mara manana mashiti kiara baratakaya. Iria la masatukura malaba. Yea, Lord. Chikaba rumba liatura bata. Kiala malandora malidia mashatura marandai. Iria malandora maramalandana masiti kiara barandara. Lord, 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 have your way, Lord. Kiara malandora marana mashiti kiara barorukura marara. In Jesus' name, yes, Lord, yes, Lord. Lord, speak to people, Lord. Speak to those that are hungry, Lord. Speak to the thirsty, Lord. Those that are desiring more of you, Lord. That you would draw them, Lord. Draw them, draw them. Lord, the Bible, Acts chapter 2, it says that you added to their numbers such those that are were being saved, Lord. Those that you were working in their lives. You were already working in their lives, and you added them to the fellowship of the believers, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Make us receptive of those that you would like to add to our number, Lord God, we pray. Prepare us, Lord, for that. Prepare us, Lord. Prepare our hearts. Prepare our hearts, Lord. in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Does anybody else want to pray into that before we move on? Jesus. Jesus. Is God speaking to anyone? Hallelujah. 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 Lord, 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 Lord. Yes, Lord. Niamalandura Malaya Marota City Kia Tokabatura Batataya Tabalatataya. Ikanamara Masitiki and Nora Moroto Ria Bataya, the Moshutukura Bada. Jesus. Yes. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. We pray for a spiritual awakening, Lord. We pray for spiritual wake up, Lord, those that are sleeping. Those that are asleep, Lord. Spiritually wake them up, Lord. Draw them, Lord. Draw them to your presence, to your goodness, your grace, your mercy. Your mercy, Lord. Your mercy, Lord. In Jesus' name, hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Yes, and let's pray for laborers again and just lift up this need. The labor, the harvest is great. Matthew 9:35. Pray for laborers. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Shira malandaria maronda basiti katara batora bata. Yes. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Chikara malande kiara marupata seta kashutura. In Jesus. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. In Jesus' name, Lord. Raise up, Lord. Laborers, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Those that are able to carry, Lord. Those that are able to push forward. Those that are able to pioneer, Lord. Laborers that can labor, Lord God, that are not afraid to work, not afraid to get going and to get roll their sleeves up and get to work, Lord. In yes, Lord, yes, Lord, raise up, Lord, those in our midst, Lord, we pray. Yes, yes, yes. The harvest is white. Can you see the harvest tonight? The harvest is white and it's ready. It's there. The harvest is there. The harvest is there. Yes, the harvest is there. Yes. Yes. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Shikala marondora mandara rabaria katataya. Ikarabasandora bashitikiara malandora bataka. Hallelujah, kiara marondora malitia kotora bataya. Yes, yes, hallelujah. Hallelujah, in the mighty name of Jesus. In the mighty name of Jesus. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah. And finally, let's just pray for, we prayed for it tonight, but pray for wisdom. And that's really the key in knowing that we need the key, right? We need keys. Keys unlock doors. And wisdom is a part of that, where we know what to do. We know what to do, and we know how to open the doors. We know how to unlock doors that are locked. And that's divine wisdom, wisdom that comes from above, that is not earthly. It's for above. It's for to accomplish the work of God and what God wants done. And so, Lord, in Jesus' name, we pray for that divine wisdom. Lord, in fact, we are already receiving it. We are already receiving wisdom. We're already getting insight into things. We're getting vision. We're seeing things. We're understanding things. What no eye can see nor ear has heard, we are hearing and we are seeing and we are understanding, Lord God. In the mighty name, yes, in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Kiara masatokora batai. Lord, give us strategy. Give us strategies that are from you, Lord. What it is that you want done in Portage, La Prairie, Manitoba. Lord, the message that is needed for this community. And I believe it's a message of faith. It's a message of good news. It's a message that God wants to bless and not curse. God wants to prosper. God has a divine and incredible future, Lord God, in the lives of people that are downtrodden and weary. And Lord, we just pray in the name of Jesus that that good news and that message will go forth in Portage La Prairie, Lord, in the mighty name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Yes. Oh, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Chikiara malandor maratataya. Oh Lord, Shiria Baloturia Malanderia Bakotopotu. Hiria Malandora Maramananana Mande. Yes, Lord. Yes. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord. Yes, 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 Lord. And finally, let's just pray for refreshing. And as even as we approach the summer season, and I know there's people that are weary, and we need times in our lives of seasons of refreshing and rejuvenation and restoring. And you know, the promise is what has been stolen, the cankerworm has taken. God can return and restore. And there are times in life we're just going through things, and things have been lost or taken or set aside. They're there, but they're just out of reach maybe, and God wants to bring them back into to reach again. Restore lives, restore laborers, Lord, in Jesus' name. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Build up, encourage, Lord. Pour into, Lord. Maybe we may be able to receive from you, Lord. Those that are heavy burden, Lord, lift burdens, lift heaviness, Lord. In Jesus' name, Lord, restore health. Restore bodies, restore physical strength, O Lord God. Restore mental strength, O Lord God. Restore emotional strength, Lord. Restore spiritual strength, Lord. Restore financial losses, O Lord God, we pray. Hallelujah. Restore families and relationships, O Lord God, we pray. In the mighty name of Jesus, Lord, have your way and restore, Lord, tonight, we pray. Restore tonight, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Shikanama. Let's stand together as we close. Pastor Depot, are you going to come? I believe in it's on the program anyways. Bless you.
Hallelujah. Please, before we close, let's just pray for Pastor Ron. That the hand of the Lord will fall upon him afresh. That the Lord will fill him again. Even Jesus says, virtue has gone out of me. That the virtues that has gone out tonight will be replenished in multiple folds in the name of Jesus. That the Lord will enrich him with the word that is meant for this season in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. Eternal Rock of Ages, we thank you for tonight. Father, we thank you for every one of us that are represented here tonight. We thank you for your grace that has brought us together. We thank you for your blood that has connected us together. And we thank you for the ability to be empowered under your name. Therefore, Lord, take all the glory in the name of Jesus. Father, Jesus said by himself that men ought to pray and not to faint. Father, the grace to use the word of tonight in a way that impacts our life and the lives of those around us. Lord, release it upon us in the name of Jesus. As we go tonight, Father, ignite us with a higher dimension of power and passion to stand in your presence in the name of Jesus. Baptize us, O Lord, with new unction to pray in the name of Jesus Christ. Father, teach us what to say and empower the words of our mouth in the name of Jesus. As we go tonight, let your presence go with us. The next time we shall meet, we shall have great testimonies. Father, I declare, let your blood build a shield around us in the name of Jesus Christ. If there be anyone that is sick in the body tonight, Father, heal them permanently in the name of Jesus. As we go, let your presence go with us. Father, as we go, give your angels charge over us. Father, we thank you. Lord, we give you all the glory. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. Amen. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the sweet fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. Amen. Surely, God's goodness and mercy shall follow us all the days of our lives, and we shall dwell in the presence of the Lord forever and ever. Amen. Thank you for coming. God bless you.